What's up, guys? Regiment in this podcast is brought to you by G Fuel, the ultimate energy drink for gamers. G Fuel uses a special blend of vitamins, antioxidants, and other natural caffeine resources to keep you from having those jitters or even that crash that you normally would have from other energy drink brands. So whether you're having a long gaming session or you're just having a long day and need a pick-me-up, G Fuel definitely has you covered. G Fuel also has a wide array of flavors to choose from. But if you don't know what flavor you want to try, they also sell variety packs on their website, and they even come with a cool shaker. So head on over to gfuel.com and use promo code REGIMENT at checkout to get up to 30% off. That is REGIMENT, promo code REGIMENT down here at checkout to get up to 30% off. Ladies and gentlemen, we're back.
We're not back.
We're
welcome
back.
Welcome to.
It's finally happened, everybody. We've got our rebrand. Our logo's done. Welcome
it is
to the Barracks Party. It is time.
It is time.
It's been a long time coming.
You have no idea. It's been over a year. It's been over a year. We've been waiting
for this. It's been a year of episodes of us saying, all right, we might be called something new next week.
Every episode has been us saying that, like, well, we might not be called this smoke pit after this episode. And just at some point, we just stopped saying it. And then just said, well, keep an eye out for the rebrand. I don't know when the fuck it's going to happen. But it's happened. We are now officially the Barracks Party. And if you've been around since before the rebrand, you know our fucking struggles and how much we've been waiting for this to finally be done and finally be over with. There's gonna be some tweaks to like some of the logos. That's what Brandon was saying.
If we need to tweak,
if we need some tweaks, then they'll be made. But for the most part, like, we're here, baby. It's it. We're finally here. If anything, I might actually change some of the overlay. That's probably it. But yes.
I think at this point, they'll forget about it, just like they had for the past year.
But yes, welcome to the Barracks Party Podcast. I am Brock. This is Doc. It's a wonderful day to be us. I just feel so relieved. Like, when I got the go-ahead, like, I was like, oh, thank God.
It finally happened. It's like an orgasm.
It's like we've been edging for a year. And we finally got it out.
We finally got released.
We finally got it out. So we got a lot of topics for you guys this week. We had to really dig deep for the military ones, but we also do have some pretty big gaming ones. There's a big one about Microsoft going on right now that a lot of people are speculating is the death of Xbox.
No.
We'll have a discussion when we get to that topic, but without further ado, let's actually front load the topic so you guys know what you're getting yourselves into, as if you didn't know that you get yourselves into some shit like this every episode. So, first one we're going to talk about is an Army unit tells mother of soldier her daughter is a sick call ranger.
Must like half of you fucks out there, too.
And it's funny because they did it they replied to her comment on a Facebook post, and I can't tell you how many times I have seen someone's a shitbag's family member comment how proud of their soldier they were on Facebook, on a Facebook post from our unit. And I just want to be like, Your son's getting kicked out for smoking fucking weed and snorting cocaine. So, or your kid got a DUI and made us all have to come in on a fucking Saturday. So, fuck your kid. So, yeah. And this is kind of funny. I'm sure this dude's going to get in trouble.
If I weren't still active duty, I would comment on so many of those posts.
Oh. Oh. Dude, so many of those posts. Like, it's funny because when you get out and you do see posts like that about somebody regarding somebody that you know is a complete piece of shit, and you can you just have the freedom to actually just call them out, because what's going to happen to you? You're going to get fucking in trouble.
Well, even just opinion-wise, like to actually voice
your opinions?
An opinion in general. And be like, this is stupid. Just to say that it's stupid. Not allowed to do it.
That's like one of the biggest things that people don't realize about the military is that when you join, your right to an opinion is gone. Like, you don't get one anymore.
You can't publicly say your opinion. You're allowed to have your opinion.
You're allowed to have an opinion.
And you can talk about it with other people. But you just can't put it into a public forum.
Right. You can't, you know. And then even in private, look at this fucking... Look at this. I don't know if you see this, but
squirrel.
Did you see the ad on Popular
Military?
I did. Military?
I saw you post it.
Yeah, it's
in the staff chat.
It's. I'm gonna change it real quick so they can see what I'm talking about. Look, kids, our fucking G Fuel can or G Fuel cup is on the website. I think that's just targeted ads, though.
Yeah, I think it's targeted.
I don't
ads
think
too.
That has anything to do with Popular Military putting G Fuel and putting our G Fuel cup or shaker on their page.
It's probably G Fuel.
This is just something that I see.
G Fuel has an ad thing with Google, and the targeted portion of it sees the regiment stuff that we have and everything else. This is the G Fuel, and they're like, let's put two and two together. Show them this, even though we already fucking have it.
Yeah, I know. Anyway, so scrolled off. Anyway, next topic. So prosecutors say a senior enlisted leader at Fort Liberty, Fort Bragg, smuggled meth, put strip club on travel card. This is the most fucking airborne
shit.
Stupidest
fucking thing you could have done.
Nah, man. This is, on a travel card, yes. But
yeah.
This is some fucking airborne shit, I'm telling you right now. Before we actually dive into that article, I'm going to speculate that this guy was part of one of the SF groups.
I mean, possibly.
I guarantee you.
At this base before?
Huh? Fort Liberty? You do know that at Fort Bragg, I'm not calling it Fort Liberty. I don't give a fuck what anybody says. At Fort Bragg is home of the Special Forces. So most of the Special Forces groups are in Bragg. At Fort Bragg, yeah. I was about to say Liberty. But no, I'm not going to say it. Fort Bragg. And they even say home of the Special Forces. So, yes. I have a sneaky, sneaky suspicion that it's probably somebody from group. We'll see. Next topic. This one's weird. Army suspends Ranger Training Battalion Commander as it investigates use of an online dating app.
I wonder if it's related to,
His lawyer
underage or
his,
like...
So his lawyer has chimed in on it.
Within the music.
Well, his lawyer has chimed in on it, and from what it sounds like is that they just relieved him for using because he was on a dating app,
probably like a public figure HR kind of thing.
I don't know,
or depending on how his profile looked, like the pictures that he used and stuff like that.
I don't know. That's the details on this are very, very scarce. There's hardly any true details of why they're investigating him. But his lawyer says nothing in the investigation is showing that they're investigating him for any real reason except for the fact that he has a dating profile on an app. Mm-hmm. Which is okay, what's your argument on that? Conduct unbecoming of an officer? Why? Because he has a dating app? Do you expect him to go out and fucking find somebody because he's a fucking lieutenant colonel? Is that really And that's honestly an unrealistic expectation. You're expecting someone to live a life a certain way, even though that it's not really how things are done anymore. You have an expectation of how... That's like having... You know, that's like someone judging me and Alicia for meeting on Hinge. some old school way of thinking is like, why didn't you just meet in church or something? Or some stupid bullshit. That's the thing. It's like, would you expect them to go find somebody at fucking church?
I can't fucking church, Linda.
I can't. I can't go pick up a girl from church and then take her home. It's a
sin. Unless it's a Catholic church.
Unless, that's a whole another story. Anyway, so Xbox reportedly plans to make more games multi-platform, meaning that a lot of their exclusives are going to be rumored. As of right now, it's just kind of like an insider, it's a reported rumor right now. Like, there's a person that is apparently a reliable source when it comes to, like, news inside of Xbox. And he brought up that it's looking like Xbox is moving a lot of their first-party exclusives to PlayStation.
Which monetarily makes sense.
Yeah, and yeah, we'll dive into the pros and cons of such move. And we'll dive into that when we actually get to it. And, you know, and a lot of people were like, if it wasn't true, you would think that Phil Spencer would actually say, like, no, that's not true. But no. Instead,
Kona versus
I meant to close an ad, and another one popped up, and I unmuted it. Instead, what he did was he came out and said he's going to reveal the future of Xbox next week. He didn't deny any of the claims, which tells me that either some or all of what people are saying is true. At the very least, some of it comes out. Well, even
I'd be
that,
okay with that.
Well, there's other games too where it's just like, what was the point of, you know, like their whole market behind the games where this is like the next level for Xbox gaming. This is like, you know, our first party exclusives and people bought Xboxes. Well, you know, this is a conversation we'll have and we'll get to it. I'll squirrel off and talk about this forever. Ubisoft Skull and Bones finally hit the beta and people are playing it, which is like, it feels like it took forever to get here, but it's here. It costs $70.
Watered down ass game.
And the CEO is defending the backlash on it, saying that that Skull and Bones is a quadruple A game, not a triple A game, a quadruple A game. It's like more better. That's basically what he's saying. It's more better.
I just want to point out all of the top games that have come out, we'll say the past year, from now back a year, have been independent companies. Or independent devs.
Yeah, so you're considering like Baldur's Gate, Alan Wake. Let's see, there's a bunch of other games.
Pal World.
Well, let's talk about the last year, like before.
That's what I mean.
Before January. Well, 2023.
Well, I'm saying going from now back a year.
From now back a year, but I'm reflecting on 2023 as a whole. If you look,
which is basically all of
2023 was a banger year for games, a huge year for games. It was probably one of the best years in games that I've seen in a long time. A lot of good games came out. However, a lot of really bad games came out. Some of the worst games I've ever fucking seen in my life came out in 2023. Gollum.
Some of them even disappeared right after the game.
Right? Yeah. Gollum, King Kong, The Walking Dead, Destinies. Two. By the way, both of those games, King Kong and Walking Dead, were rated the worst games of 2023 by the same fucking developer and publisher. And the name of the publisher, their name is Game Mill, which essentially, like, they are a game mill. They crank out cheaply made video games to try to make a profit. Anyway, and then you had fucking The Day Before that came out too. That nightmare. So a game so bad that you can't even fucking get it anymore. Within a month of its existence, it's gone. You can't even play the game. Anyway.
Should have got it The Day Before.
Speaking of recent games, Pal World, but like you said. So we talked about this game a little while back. Blake was on with us when we were actually talking about
your narrator.
Was on when we first talked about this. And then we talked about it again.
It was during the State of Play or something like that from last year.
Yeah.
Almost exactly a year ago. You can go back and watch your narrator one. It's like an hour and 37 minutes in and watch the first, because I brought it up to you and you're like, the fuck are you talking about? And we get to it, we watch you can see us reacting to the trailer and we're like, The fuck is this shit?
Like, this is Pokemon
fucking copyright. How is this still legal?
Like, I was like, this looks way too close to Pokemon. There's no way this game will see the light of day. And it came out, and then believe it or not, it comes out, and it ends up breaking fucking records on Steam. It is now in Steam history the second most concurrent player base in Steam history. Mm-hmm. Now, not so much, but you know, because number one's PUBG. You could probably argue that now PUBG is like not as great as it was when it got to number one, but it has the most down. It's like the most played game in Steam, like the second most played game in Steam history, which is crazy mm-hmm. because this game, yeah. when all of us thought it was a fucking meme. We didn't think it was real.
Literally.
Like, we thought it was
never
a meme.
Never thought it was going to be. And the quality of it, like, if you played it,
it's good.
Phenomenal.
It's awesome. I was surprised. I was just like, why is fucking Nintendo
even
taking
notes
on this?
Even for the state that it's released in, like, it's an early alpha.
I know.
Like, a pre-release alpha, basically. They're just letting people play it.
And there's going to be a lot more to come, and I feel so bad for the developers because there's only, like, 10 of them. And they didn't even expect this game to blow up the way it did. And they're desperately trying to get help. But we'll talk about that, too. But first, one of the things that we brought up was, like, there's no way Nintendo and Pokemon don't fucking sue them. And Pokemon responded.
I think they didn't until they saw how fucking
popular it got.
And they're like, that's our money.
Yeah. So that's honestly, that's what a lot of people are saying is that Pal World is only getting investigated because Pokemon came out and said they are investigating Pal World for potential IP infringement. And I honestly don't think they would have ever have done that had Pal World not been as successful as it is.
Because they've had plenty of fucking time.
They had years. In fact, the game was announced, actually revealed, not announced and revealed before we saw it.
Yeah.
So they've had, since the announcement of the game, to investigate, and they didn't, and only are only doing it now because of how popular it got.
Yep.
But back to what I was saying with Pal World is, like, the devs are kind of in, like, fucking panic mode trying to figure out how to hire people. Microsoft stepped in so that they would help Pal World scale up as one of its all-time biggest Game Pass launches. Because the game is on Game Pass, and
that's a massive
and
thing.
And it is
to
its all time largest, biggest Game Pass release, which is crazy. So Microsoft's like, yeah, we'll help you out with like your server issues and you know if you're like your Battle Pass stuff and like Microsoft is offering, and there's even like speculation that Microsoft might buy the company.
That'd be crazy.
You know, despite the fact that Microsoft just laid off 2,000 fucking people after the most profitable year in its existence.
Crazy, right?
I know. It's weird how that works.
Corporate profits are through the roof, yet people are getting laid
off. It's funny
how
that works.
I wonder how that fucking works.
You know, rich people doing rich people shit. Yay.
Like, they're like, give us the money. All right.
You give me money. Yeah, like, thank
you. You can fuck off.
And it's fucking crazy. But most of the people that got let go were in the physical media part. So, like, disc games. They're not doing that shit anymore.
Gotcha. Yeah, that kind of makes sense in that way then.
Back in the military news front, so a sacked commander accused sailors of mansplaining and then put her hands on them. You know,
sacked commander. What does that even mean?
Fired.
That's a terrible
You've never heard term. The term getting sacked?
I have, but just in this sense, it just feels wrong.
Why? Feels like teabagging?
I don't know. I just didn't.
Do you think teabagging when you think sacked?
No.
I do.
Just the way in the context of that it is. Well, it also says it put her hands on them. You immediately just think, was she tackled? I don't understand.
I don't know. We'll
I just
find
don't get
out.
Fired from it.
We'll
I
find out.
That's what it means.
We'll find out when we read more into it. But it's kind of funny because it's was she Navy or Coast Guard?
Navy.
Navy. Oh, and you know, the Navy's always blaming other issues for retention and recruitment. But you know, it's got, you know, toxic leadership isn't the reason at all. It can't be. It can't be. It never is. That's not true. Toxic leadership is a myth. You know, it's fake.
It's
news.
A fizzy, it's a wazzy, it's a woozy. It doesn't exist. It's a figment of your imagination.
Yeah, you're just pretending. It's all in your head.
Michael Mahoney?
I don't know.
A little snippet. He's like, it's a fizzy, it's a wazzy, it's a foos.
I don't even know.
Fairy dust. It doesn't exist.
And then we'll cap this off with a very interesting story. South Korean EA FIFA pro was found guilty for faking low IQ to avoid military service. He was pretending to be mentally handicapped to get out of being in the service, because in South Korea, service is mandatory. And he was pretending to be mentally handicapped so that he didn't have to serve. And they caught him. And there's a lot of fucking jokes that I could give with this. But I'm not going to do it. Not going to do it.
Say again?
I said there's a lot of jokes I can think with that one, and I'm not going to do it.
Well, I missed it. The retarded thing?
No, the South Korean... The joke was a South Korean, not smart.
He's a Bijan.
What's a Bijan?
He's not Asian. Not A's. You smart. You know, get B's.
Oh, okay. I got it now. I'm like, what's a Bijan?
That was my wife's first, her first Twitch name, because she's Filipino.
Was Bijan?
Her first Twitch name was Bijan, not Asian.
Why? Because she was a B student?
I think it's because she didn't do as good in high school or in college as she originally like wanted, and she didn't do nursing like her mom wanted her to do, like most Filipinos apparently do.
Interesting.
Yeah,
but yeah, this is so it's interesting because this whole article, like, I find it fascinating that someone would go as far. I think of the TikTok that I saw of a sketch of the dude getting wheeled. He's playing a prank on his friend. It's like a skit where it's like, obviously all of the people that are doing this are acting, where the mom is rolling the son into the living room and he's just like, ah, like that. They're like, what? And his friend's like, what happened to him? And he's not actually like, he has anything wrong with him.
Of course.
Oh man, we're going to get canceled quick. Anyway.
Probably.
Yeah. But
we just started, and the Barracks Party is being shut down.
Welcome to the Barracks Party. Goodbye. We're no longer a thing.
Partied a little too hard.
We partied a little too hard. But you know what? You know, the reason why we're called the Barracks Party, and let's get into that real quick. So, obviously, the Smoke Pit was a name that's already been kind of taken by people.
Multiple people.
Multiple people, including people that we wanted to have on. Which, by the way, get a hold of them, because we're not the Smoke Pit anymore, and now they could get on.
We got to change the Spotify and everything, too.
We got to change the Spotify. That's why I was asking Jake for the graphics. So I'm like, I got to change the Spotify. I got to change the Twitter. I got to change a bunch of shit. But the Barracks Party is called the Barracks Party because, honestly, if you think about everything that we talk about and everything that we do on this podcast, it's essentially like a Barracks Party. And we even said it's a Barracks Party without the bunny. So, you know, it makes sense. Like, sometimes we'll have some drinks and we'll just talk about video games, talk about bullshit that happens in the military, because that's what you do at a barracks party. Like, how often at a barracks party have you talked shit about someone in your chain of command or someone in some part of the military or some stupid story that's happened? Every time.
Mm-hmm.
And essentially, that's why we are the barracks.
Gaming going on.
It's fitting. It's fitting for what we are, you know? But anyway, I'm elated that this has happened. Like, that it's finally happened. It feels like it wasn't going to get here, you know?
All of our work has been recognized.
It's finally
come
here.
Come to fruition.
Sorry, Laura.
What?
Oh, do you have me muted? Do you have yourself muted because of me? I'm so sorry. She's playing a game with her cousin. And I told her she can while I do this, but just be mindful of the fact that I'm probably going to be a nut job this whole time. Anyway, let's get into our topics because we have a lot to cover, and
Laura to suck it up.
And we want to play Helldivers after this, so we're going to get into it. Oh, you mean to tell me that we do like to play video games and, like, you know, we don't just sit here and do this all the time? Yes. We have lives. All right, so Army unit tells mother of soldier her daughter is a sick call ranger. So
much like most of y'all fucking are.
Yeah, most of you is. So an engineering based out of Fort Riley, Kansas, an engineering unit based out of Fort Riley, Kansas, is reportedly under fire after they publicly shamed a female soldier who did not attend a cold weather march. It all began on January 19th when the Best Company, or the Beast, when the Beast Company of the 1st Engineer Battalion posted photos on Facebook showing their troops operating in frigid weather. Fort Riley was a little quiet this morning, I guess. Nobody except Beast Company wanted to do any real cold weather training, the post began. 7-mile ruck march and some negative 10 wind chill helps build resiliency in all aspects of life. Let's be honest. No, the fuck it doesn't.
No, it doesn't.
We're doing resiliency training by being fucking miserable for no reason.
No, that's just one commander that had a bright fucking fairy idea.
You know, it was like, the good
go
idea.
Let's go on a muck march in the cold.
The good idea. Fairy bit an officer a little too hard, and he was like, you know what? Tomorrow's going to suck. Let's do a 7-mile ruck.
No warming layers.
No, and if you really look at the photo, they don't have any warming layers on. This dude, like, right here, the look on his face. Let's see if I can zoom into his face a bit. Yeah, look at his face. Like, when the more I zoom in, the more it looks like he's wearing a mask of a person's flesh. The guy on the right, he's got ice in his mustache. Been there. I know how that feels, buddy. And this guy behind him is, like, barely wearing anything. Looks like he's got mechanics gloves on and his cold weather cap. And that's it. But his face, if you zoom in and look at his face is that of pure, absolute misery. Fucking misery. I know how you
as
feel.
As all fucking ruck marches are.
Dude, yeah.
Now, I will say, they tell us, I understand no warming layers or a minimal warming layers on the event because your body does still heat up.
You will
still overheat. And in that environment, that's dangerous, especially sweat.
Dude,
if they're camping out there and everything.
And I've seen that happen. Like, where a guy heat-catted because he was over-layered, and because they took off, because he was sweating and everything underneath, when they took his shit off, he went hypothermic almost instantly.
Yeah. So.
And he had to get medevaced.
I get that aspect. But when they say no warming layers in the fucking 3 hours that you're just standing around before you fucking step off,
you mean
suck my ass.
PT formation?
Well, when they're like, we're going to go to the armory. We're going to step off at 7. It's 4 in the morning. We're waiting on commander. And then we're going to step off till like fucking 9 because he's not there yet.
Or your morning PT and it's freezing cold outside and one person forgot to bring gloves. So everybody has to fucking downgrade all
everyone
their
suffers.
Cold weather.
Everybody suffers
because of that fucking one. Anyway.
Uniformity.
So, a social media user dubbed Letty DN responded with, God bless you guys. I'm proud of my daughter. Beast Company, or whoever was behind their social media account. Oh, this wasn't an individual. This was the company.
Yeah.
Okay.
This is what the actual company, or whoever runs the company account, said it as the company.
Spare no tact. Letty DN, thanks for your support, the post read. Your daughter chose to go to sick call this morning instead of completing the training. Maybe next time. In short order, criticism began flooding in with individuals attacking the unit for shaming their sick call ranger. Beast Company, 1st Engineer Battalion, you should take care of your soldiers instead of humiliating them. User Yikes responded, smells like an EO complaint to me. Smells like someone's fucking pussy hurts to me. Anyway.
Well, I mean, if you think about it, this is a bad look. Because one,
it really
we
is.
Don't know truly what she went to sick call for.
She could have.
It could have been a legitimate fucking issue.
And yeah, there's a lot of times where, and this is why a lot of people don't go to sick call. For shit like this. And it's pretty wild that they went and made fun of her to her mother on Facebook. Yeah. Because it's like...
And as the company, it wasn't just an individual. It was the company's account.
It would be different if it was like some specialist who was just disgruntled and making fun of her.
That's fine.
But
whatever.
It's the company Facebook account that did this.
Like, this is not good. You're just discouraging other soldiers from going to sick call. Whether she is a sick call ranger or not doesn't take away her right. One, to go to sick call, and two, we don't know fucking HIPAA. Oh, I know HIPAA, but we don't know what the fuck she went for.
She could have actually had like a serious injury and needed to go to sick call, or like, you know,
she could have been pregnant and went to go get her fucking test. We don't know
anything. It could be. It literally could be anything.
She wants to go get an IUD so she doesn't get pregnant. I don't fucking know.
So
maybe she's got herpes.
I was going for more, less humiliating medical reasons, but all right. So others pointed out that while malingering is a genuine army problem, there were better ways to handle it. I mean, malingering can be an issue, wrote John. Ocean man Fannin, known for his rowing across the Atlantic several years ago. This definitely was handled poorly and should have never been posted. But if you're sandbagging and shitbagging, and only if you make a habit out of it, you deserve humiliation.
And we don't even know that from this context.
Right. From this context, it looks like she was just in sick call that one time. Others noted
and
how
they're just shitting on her.
Others noted how the unit was deleting comments at an alarmingly fast rate and began tagging every higher ranking element on social media. I foresee a unit at Fort Riley not having a Facebook page for very much longer, one user wrote. And that safe to say is probably true. It is wild that the company Facebook page is the one that said that.
It could get removed. Or what's more likely to happen, especially if it's a junior personnel running it, the person that every person that has the access to that account is about to get fucked.
Oh, yeah, they are. All right, so the next
they're going to whittle it down to the lowest man on the totem pole.
They always do. Shit rolls downhill. All right, so the next topic, one that I've actually been the one that I speculated about. So prosecutors say a senior enlisted leader at the Fort Liberty smuggled in meth and put strip club on travel card. Here's another reason why I say an SF group. The Arrowhead. Let's see. A senior non-commissioned officer based out of Fort Liberty, Fort Bragg, North Carolina, faces numerous charges tied to a years-long scheme to smuggle methamphetamine across the U.S.-Mexico border. Military prosecutors say Sergeant Major Jorge Garcia, the career counselor for U.S. Army Forces Command, or ForceCom. Oh, it was a ForceCom Sergeant Major. Made numerous unauthorized trips abroad between 2021 and 22. Smuggled meth, lied to his unit about his whereabouts, engaged in fraudulent charges on his government travel card at a nightclub near the Pentagon, and coordinated the drug activity with gangs online. Damn, Sergeant Major. And you bitch at me for walking on the grass. It's the latest.
Do as I say, not as I do.
Yeah, I know, right? It's always like that. It's the latest in a string of drug-related criminal activity from soldiers at Fort Liberty, the base previously known as Fort Bragg. It's Bragg. Shut the fuck up. And the highest-profile installation of the Army, serving as the home of the 82nd Airborne Division and several of the service's elite special operations units. Garcia, who's been in the military pretrial confinement since June 2023, and his attorney could not be reached to comment ahead of the publication. It was unclear, as of Thursday, whether Garcia had entered a plea to the military court or if he will face additional charges from a civilian court.
He'll get both.
This is a long article.
You're allowed to get double. It's not that long. It just looks like a lot.
So court documents say Garcia traveled abroad or lied about his whereabouts at least five times since 2021. Authorities said at least one of those occasions included travel to Tijuana, Mexico. That trip included cyber-related activities in support of a criminal gang by promotion of such activity with the knowledge of such activities involve an extremist cause.
That's very wordy,
and for those of us, like you Marines, that means he did a bad thing really badly. So Garcia was seemingly caught in May 2023 at San Ysidro, at a border town in California just outside of San Diego.
Authorities get caught there for sure.
Oh, yeah. Authorities found him with about 24 pounds of meth. Damn. A highly potent illegal stimulant, we know.
That's a lot of meth.
That's a lot of meth. Fucking okay, Heisenberg. With intent to distribute, court shows. So Garcia also allegedly accrued $241.89 charge at the Flirt Lounge. Okay, so it was $200-some that he spent.
That's pretty significant, though. Bro, every deployment I've been on, especially with the Marines, we'll go to some port, some dumbass, or even mistakenly, they'll use their government travel card by accident instead of their regular card.
Yeah.
Because, like, it just in their little thingy, it's it's that they pull the wrong one.
Yeah.
They'll get notified and like their command will come up to them like, yo, why the fuck did you use your government travel card for a stuffed animal or whatever that like they sent to their wife or some shit. And they have to explain and like do this whole big ass page 13 shit. And like some of them will legitimately get in trouble. Yeah. Some people will use it in the sense of like, oh, it's a credit card. I'm just going to pay it off. And they get fucked. Because they like they immediately get notified of that shit.
That's how. So abuse of a government travel card is actually a guy that I know who was with, who was at Bragg with a special forces group, got kicked out of group for using a government travel card irresponsibly. And by the way, in case you guys didn't know, you can get kicked out of the special forces groups and lose your green beret and your long tab.
You know what's partially hilarious to me, though, about it? We still fucking pay that off, though.
Well, you have to. It's a debt. Yeah, we won't pay off our debt. No, but I mean, but
like, so, like, DTS, for example, which is a terrible fucking system. If
unless you know the person running it.
Regardless, it's a shit system. When we put in our travel claim, they may pay that off. But if there's any extra balance, we have to pay that off. And, like, in the Navy, when we use our travel card between station, like PCS, we have to pay that balance off regardless. Our travel claim will not automatically do it. Our travel claim will help us in paying that off, obviously, but it doesn't directly go to the card. So no matter what, we have to fucking pay that off. Like, it's coming from our account. So I think the level of trouble that you can get with it is a bit extreme because it's still connected to us. In no way is it taking government money.
No, you're paying for it if it's something that isn't going to get paid for by the government. Like,
exactly.
Like your extra purchases that you make on it is going to come out of your paycheck anyway.
Exactly. So I think we take things a bit extreme with the travel card for no reason.
I agree. Yeah, I agree. I mean, in that context, yes, I agree. I didn't realize that. Yes, we have to pay for any extra expenses that aren't covered under the government travel card. We have to pay for that ourselves. I always just thought the government had to pay for it. But anyway, so.
And you can see the transactions and what they're named.
Right. I mean, it even says right here, he spent $241.89 charged at the Flirt Lounge in Arlington, Virginia, a nightclub less than 2 months. You know where that is, don't you?
No, it's just the Flirt Lounge.
The Flirt Lounge. This is a shitty strip club name. A nightclub less than 2 miles from the Pentagon in October 2021 on his government travel card.
I bet that's where all of our senators and everybody go.
I guarantee it. So the news follows a 15-year sentencing of Gordon Cuttis last month, the former Fort Liberty soldier who held the rank of specialist and served as a medic for trafficking ketamine while on duty and laundering more than $700,000. His wife, Sergeant Shabaya Wright, also indicted in the scheme and is awaiting trial. So Fort Liberty has the most overdose deaths among all military installations, according to the Pentagon data, with 31 deaths between 2015 and 2021.
Well, I couldn't imagine where it would come from. Maybe the 24 pounds of meth?
Usually it's heroin. Early last year, at least 13 soldiers assigned to Army Special Operations Command were under investigation for drug trafficking, which was coke. The base in the so-called Corridor H and a designation from the Justice Department of 8 different parts of the country in which drugs, particularly fentanyl, are heavily trafficked. And the corridor encompasses I-95, a highway that stretches from Miami to Houlton, Maine. In March 2022, Specialist Jacob Dickerson was sentenced to 75 days in prison. 75 days? Removed from service and given a bad conduct discharge after a plea agreement, according to the Army Corps records. Dickerson was a military officer at Fort Liberty who sold oxycodone, an opioid used to treat pain, out of his military police vehicle at least once.
Wow.
He was assigned. So, Bragg has a drug problem, kids. It almost reminds me of the fucking heroin and cocaine problems that we had in Vicenza.
Which is the one that has the soldiers dying and missing problem?
Hood?
Oh, that's Hood. Okay. All right.
Fort Hood,
Bragg,
Texas?
Drugs, Hood's got the murder. Got it.
I mean, Bragg has murder, too, but Hood is mostly known for murder, which is fucking weird.
Disappearance.
I mean, there was that one female soldier that like,
yeah.
And the dude that was gonna get charged killed himself.
Did he?
Oh yeah, he killed himself.
Sounds like Epstein. Did he?
I think in this case, yes. I think he was trying to avoid getting charged. Yeah, because he was going to get fucking hammered. So
speaking of hammers, you see that Drake video?
Yeah, yeah. Unfortunately, I did.
He just said, "Man, I hear slang."
I got fucking caught up in that because I was just like, "What the fuck is? Why is?" I was like, "Oh, why is Drake trending?" And then I found out the hard way of why he was trending.
Oh, this shit was so funny.
It was like, you know, but good for him though. Good for him. Good for Drake.
I think it's bullshit. Man's rich and well endowed. This is fucking, you gotta choose, pick one.
I mean, it explains why. I think I read somewhere where he would put hot sauce in his used condoms.
Yes.
That was him?
Well, that's because, I mean, he's rich, too. You got to think how many people are trying to fucking get him caught up.
And then also explains Amanda Bynes' tweet saying that Drake would murder her pussy. And it's like, after seeing that shit, I believe that.
Him and Pete Davidson just tearing through fucking Hollywood.
Yeah, I mean, like, I bet you fucking Pete Davidson's got a hog on him, too.
Everyone says that he does.
Do they really?
Yeah,
I mean,
just to think of the people that he's been with, everyone says that. Yeah, he's like, fucking
because it's
massive.
Like, it's funny because Pete Davidson, like he bagged Kim Kardashian, right? Mm-hmm. Who, by the way, Pete Davidson is not like a kind of guy that you would ever think Kim Kardashian would go for. She goes for like musicians, athletes. Mostly athletes, Ray J.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, well, musician.
Yeah, I know. I was like musicians and athletes. So like Ray J, fucking other athletes. I can't. Who was the one NFL player that she was dating? Reggie Bush. It was Reggie Bush. She was dating Reggie Bush for a bit. Wait, was that Kim that was dating him or was that Kylie Jenner?
It could have been either one.
I don't know. It all fucking runs together for me. But yeah, so like musicians, athletes, I mean, she was with Kanye, she was with Ray J. I think she was
drives
with
them all insane.
Dude, I think, yes. And I'm very happy to see that Pete Davidson wasn't one of them because I've noticed the trend that anybody that dates Kim Kardashian has some, like if they're an athlete, they play like shit. If they're a musician, they fucking fall apart. And in, like, other cases, they just lose their minds. Kanye, but honestly, I think a lot of other things factored in.
He's
Kanye.
Bipolar.
Well, he's not only that, but he also, didn't he have, like, a severe head injury, too? He got hit by a car or some shit?
That I don't know. I just know he's been bipolar for,
like,
years.
I remember hearing that he actually got hit, like, something happened. He got a serious head injury. And
that's possible.
And kind of hasn't been the same since.
He's been bipolar for, like, 20 years, though.
Yeah. Well, the guy's got mental health issues already. Right. And then on top, like, pile that on top of being with Kim Kardashian. That can't be a fun time. No.
Joe Rogan has a skit about this, too.
I'm sure he does.
In one of his comedy specials.
I remember seeing a TikTok where Kim Kardashian's kid fucking asked, "Mom, why are you famous?" And she really couldn't answer.
Well, they talked about the family.
It's our family in general that drives you insane.
Because they're like, one, you got an American Olympic athlete who's a woman now. You got Kanye, who's lost his damn mind.
And not even just that, but I mean, like, if you look at, like, who Kim Kardashian's dad is, he was part of the legal team for O.J. Simpson. That's how the Kardashians became famous.
Interesting.
And, like, yeah. And then,
kinda awkward.
And then, what's Bruce Jenner's new name now?
Caitlyn
Jenner. I could only remember Bruce Jenner. I couldn't remember the Caitlyn part. I always forget that one.
Canceled.
Listen, you want to get pissed at me for dead naming somebody? I can't remember what their fucking current name is, okay? This is why, like, when people get mad at people for dead naming, it's like, well, I don't remember the new name.
What is dead naming?
Dead naming is a term when someone, like, transitions and they go by a different name. And you call them by the name, like, let's say that, like, I like you, for example, like you're Brandon, right? Like, let's say that
it's
if you
name
were,
I haven't heard in years.
Let's say that you transition. I know everyone calls you Doc, but like, it's like, let's say you transition and now you're Brenda, but people still call you Brandon. Like, that's dead naming, and people get fucking pissed at that. And even more so, like, in certain countries, like, they'll...
I understand. It's just a term. I never knew it was a term.
Yeah.
I feel educated.
It's just like, but it's like, I feel like, why... Don't get mad at me. It's like, I don't know what your new fucking name is. Like, I've always known you as this. Don't get upset at me by me calling you what I've always known.
I have TBI. Leave me alone.
Yeah, I have memory issues. I have a TBI. I've got 100 concussions in my lifetime. I don't remember a lot of things, okay?
I got erectile dysfunction. Leave me alone.
Regiment in this podcast is also partnered with BR Paradox. BR Paradox is a company that specializes in custom-built PCs. So if you have an idea for a cool custom-built PC, they can definitely give you the hookup on that. But if you're not in the market for custom PCs, BR Paradox is a wide array of pre-built PCs that you could choose from at great prices. And if you're not in the market right now for a new PC, BR Paradox will definitely hook you up with an optimization. Optimizations take around 10-15 minutes to do, and they're very awesome. I highly recommend them. I had my PC optimized by them, and it's never run smoother since. BR Paradox also has a list of renowned customers ranging from LeBron James, Chris Brown, members of FaZe Clan, and even Angela White from your favorite Orange and Black site, if you know what I mean. So head on over to brparadox.com to get yourself a PC today or an optimization. And remember to use promo code REGIMENT at checkout. That's promo code REGIMENT down here at checkout. All right, so our next topic.
How is that related?
What? It's not. Army suspends Ranger Training Battalion Commander as it investigates the use of the online dating app. I don't know which one. It never names it. So a Ranger...
Probably because they don't want to put... It's probably a legal thing, honestly.
It might be. I'm going to guess Tinder. A Ranger school commander was suspended in January amid an investigation into his conduct over online dating. Lieutenant Colonel Nathan E. Showman was suspended in January 26th from his position as commander of the 5th Ranger Training Battalion at Camp Merrill, Dahlonega, Georgia, according to the service spokesman. The suspension was first reported by the Army Times. The investigation
was a loss in trust and confidence.
You know what? I will click on the Army Times one after I read this. The investigation is related to Showman's use of a dating profile and subsequent consensual relationships, according to his attorney. This investigation is in no way accusing Lieutenant Colonel Showman of sexual harassment or any similarly related allegation.
We should have used the Army Times one.
Rather, it appears the Army is attacking a single heterosexual male and his desire to have a dating profile and to have consensual dating relationships with other adults. It's unclear whether Showman had relationships with other soldiers, but which could have potentially violated some Army's fraternization rules, but Capovilla said that the relationships were not with subordinates. We're confident in Lieutenant Colonel Showman's ability to continue to lead and continue to be a successful officer in the United States Army. Showman took command of the 5th Ranger. That's good history lessons. Ranger school is conducted in 3 phases. I don't care.
Use the Military Times one. It's a lot shorter.
Is it? Yeah, because the rest of it's talking about Ranger School, and it's like they're just filling the article. So let's read the Army Times one.
It's a lot shorter.
This dude looks like a fucking Ranger. This dude looks like every Ranger I've ever seen. Like, I'm not even lying. This dude is a Ranger, 100%. He's got the look. He doesn't have his tambourine, though. Where's your scroll, sir? Where's your scroll? Anyway. So it says in this article... the commander of the 5th Ranger has been suspended. Let's see.
That was the third article. Or the third paragraph.
Oh, look at that. Our Regiment G Fuel thing is showing up on 2 different ads. Let's see.
I don't have that. That's definitely targeted.
Yeah, I know. So, yeah, this one doesn't really tell you anything either. So it's like... So it really does kind of look like they're targeting this guy for having a dating profile.
Which is kind of fucked up.
It's extremely fucked up.
You must be alone, sir. That's what they're telling
it's
you.
Like, but it's like, why are you giving this guy shit for having a fucking dating app?
Like, if he were supposed to have a significant other, the Army would issue it to him.
Okay, but they're not going to fucking bust soldiers' balls for marrying strippers.
That's unrelated.
They're not going to suspend them for that?
Nope. But they're gonna get theirs.
But a guy is on a dating app, like regardless of how he's using the dating app, if there's no issues with anybody afterwards, like no allegations of anything.
Because he makes decisions and he's in a position of power, and they're like, we can't have this.
That's not fair.
You must be single and alone.
That's not fair. And this is the shocker. An NCO is defending an officer in this case. That's not fair. That's really not fair that they're gonna fucking take this dude's leadership positions away from him for the simple fact that he has a fucking Tinder profile. That's bullshit.
There's got to be more to it, though. There has to be. Otherwise, this would never stand. This would be an EO complaint.
Well,
1,000%.
So here's the thing, right? If there was more to it, the articles would say.
Not necessarily. Because we all know the military doesn't give you any fucking information until everything comes out. Rightfully so, to be fair.
Yeah.
Where, like, civilian, they'll give you, like, the whole damn thing, and you're like, they haven't been found guilty or innocent of anything, and you already basically know the quote-unquote whole story. The military is like, we ain't saying shit until we got everything, and everything is finalized. If you don't know, you don't know.
Well, the other thing is, so I'm looking at this. The investigation is all about a suspension, and he's not actually being charged with anything. His lawyer is only involved because he's trying to fight it.
Yeah, because that's like an EO thing, too.
Yeah, so it's like, that's the other reason why I'm like, I don't think there was really anything bad he was doing.
They may have just been trying to find a reason to suspend him, too. Maybe they didn't like him.
Could be.
He was holding people accountable, and they're like, get him out of here.
Get him out of here, which is weird because it's Ranger school. Like,
he's not complying with what we say. Get him out.
All right, gaming time. It's gaming news time. I'm excited for this one. There's a lot of big ones. Well, not a lot. This is the biggest
one. That's
what she said. So many big ones. Hang on, I gotta actually. I gotta fix your fucking camera on this thing. I'm gonna narrow you down a bit right here. Because it shows the black borders of your Discord thing, which I don't want to show.
Oh, that's gotta be the thumbnail right there.
What you doing the thing is the screen is your camera view on this and the scene that I'm in is too small to use. All right. So Xbox reportedly plans to make more games multi-platform. Xbox is apparently moving away from exclusives with Hi-Fi Rush, Sea of Thieves, and more said to go multi-platform. And the more is rumored to be Gears of War and Starfield.
I heard about Starfield.
So Xbox is...
I want Forza. I really want Forza.
Who knows? Xbox is reportedly planning to announce a huge change in strategy, launching more of its games on rival platforms. This comes amid growing evidence that Hi-Fi Rush will get ported to both PlayStation and Switch.
What's Hi-Fi Rush?
I don't really understand what the game is. I saw it and I was like, it didn't look like something I would play. So giving more players access to one of the most critically acclaimed Xbox exclusives of this generation. Multiple sources say that Xbox director Sarah Bond will unveil the new strategy this spring while also explaining the reasoning behind it. So far, the possibility of Xbox making more games multi-platform has proven controversial, with fans typically frustrated due to brand loyalty or feeling a bit misled about their Xbox console purchase. So the latest rumors come from Xbox reporter Idle Sloth, who says that Sarah Bond will address the community soon. It's said that Bond will go over Xbox's strategy regarding Hi-Fi Rush, Sea of Thieves, and other games going multi-platform.
See if these nuts fit in your mouth.
The reasoning behind the move will apparently also be explained, including that it's metrics-driven, so more likely to help sales. She'll also reportedly say that online pushback isn't considered, but concerns are valid. This report is backed up by Microsoft insider Jez Corden from Windows Central. Alongside the leaks Hi-Fi Rush coming to Switch and PlayStation, it looks like we can expect a lot more Xbox exclusives to make their way to other platforms and not just the expected PC port. This is a very different strategy from what Xbox has pulled so far in the console generation. For the past few years, the company has made the most of the numerous studios it's acquired, only putting their new releases on Xbox and PC. And always on Game Pass from launch. If we're about to see that change so significantly, it's possible that this hasn't driven hardware sales and Game Pass subscriptions on its way in the way it had expected. So basically what they're saying is that, and this is not news, The Xbox Series X and Series S did not sell well in the last couple years. They're actually behind everything. So it makes sense that, you know, the and also Game Pass hasn't been doing good. A lot of people aren't using it. They're just going to Steam and shit.
Because they also want to own their games too.
That too.
That's why they made it to where the very basic version of Xbox Live is Game Pass.
Yeah. So it remains to be seen what this means for other titles. Just recently, Xbox showcased some of its upcoming exclusives, including Avowed and Senua's Saga Hellblade 2. Right now, they're both poised to skip rival platforms, but with this announcement in spring, that could change. So here, okay, so let's weigh in the pros and cons if this is true, right? So the pros, more people will get to play these games, which is great.
Yeah, which means more money.
I like how this conveniently left Starfield and Gears of War out, but that was also part of some that are being rumored to be put to PlayStation.
Mm-hmm.
The pros that, yes, more people will get to play games. Xbox is looking to make more money because they aren't feeling Xbox and Game Pass right now are profitable, because as of right now, they're kind of not.
It extends the longevity of the game, too.
Right. But here is the con. If Xbox is going to put all their exclusives on PlayStation anyway, what's the point of having an Xbox?
Yeah, it's less inclination to get an Xbox.
And then you have all these
people. When it's already doing so bad.
And you have all these people that made that decision to just pick Xbox so that they could play the games that they were promised would be exclusives, and they're finding out that they won't be. But and on the other hand of that, do you think Sony is going to put any of their exclusives on Xbox? Absolutely not.
Actually, maybe. And great example, Helldivers 2. The first PlayStation game that's ever released
on PC.
But it's not on Game Pass.
It's not.
And it's a Sony game.
But that's only on Steam. Here now that's you got to think.
Still, Steam, that's a huge thing.
So Steam is not a rival in the console generation, whereas Xbox is. So I could see Sony putting their games on PC, but I don't see them putting their games on Xbox or Game Pass. And speaking of Game Pass, there's also been talk that Call of Duty will no longer be going on Game Pass.
I just thought of something.
The big thing everyone was arguing about that PlayStation was arguing about with Xbox, and that it was like the whole part of the acquisition with Activision, that they were putting Call of Duty games on Game Pass, and now they're not going to do it. On top of that, a lot of the people they laid off of the 2000, a lot of them were from Activision. And then you have the Blizzard.
Those cuts were coming regardless.
Yeah, well, the Blizzard CEO steps down and then gets replaced. The chief writer of Blizzard stepped down. So it's like they bought Activision Blizzard, and all these people lost their jobs. They like clean house. It's crazy. Now what were you saying?
You know what I could see? I could see Microsoft talking to Sony and coming to a collaboration deal. Because we all know Sony's PlayStation Plus sucks. It's not that great.
No.
It's good for older games in the sense of like you can download and play some like PlayStation 1 titles and a few PlayStation 2 titles here and there. And that's cool. But in the overall sense, it's not anything compared to Game Pass, honestly.
No, it's not.
Any progress that they've made is because they've just copied Game Pass. I could see them collaborating with PlayStation to where PlayStation Plus is more for older games, right? If you want PlayStation Plus and access to like past PlayStation games, PlayStation Plus is for you. Well, you got the very basic, whatever you got to pay for to play online, and then like the expanded Plus versions to play the older games. And then it's not going to be called Xbox Game Pass. It's just going to be called Game Pass, where it's going to have everything. Where it's got the Xbox titles, it's got PlayStation titles, and just the ones that are everywhere.
Your thought process was going the same way mine was. I was thinking, like, what if PlayStation and Xbox are actually working out some kind of... But it's weird if that does happen, because Sony is very, very against sharing anything.
But they love money. And if they don't have to compete anymore, then it takes away that aspect.
They would be competing because they'd be splitting the profits between them and Microsoft. If they have a shared Game Pass where Xbox titles and PlayStation titles are all in one subscription that they both put shit in, you'll see it. I can guarantee if that happens, you will see a massive increase in that subscription.
Exactly. So no matter what they stand, they'll make more money. And if they don't, if let's say it goes down the route, the Xbox is going to kind of not really make Xboxes all that much anymore, if at all. And they're going more towards like this cloud type service thing and like studio build based stuff, or even hell, like Steam and all that, whatever. Less console based, right? What's to compete with? You don't have another whole ass console to compete
which
with.
Also raises a problem that Sony would almost have the monopoly in the console generation.
No, they don't, because you still got Nintendo.
Nintendo's its own thing. If you really think about it, when it comes to consoles.
I agree, but it's still a console.
It's still a console, but Nintendo games, I don't really consider them in competition with Sony and Xbox or PlayStation.
None of us do, but legally wise, it's not a monopoly.
In a way, it kind of is, because if like you have, then you have the Switch and the PlayStation and Microsoft, and the Xbox is just gone. Whereas everyone just now gets a PlayStation or a Nintendo. So yeah, you got one console for everybody, but then you have all these people that bought an Xbox that are now going to be fucked out of anything that comes out new. Now they got to go buy a PlayStation. Good luck. You know?
Just won't have further Xboxes, is what I'm saying.
There's a lot of anti-consumer shit with that, if they were to do that.
It would just be the less, like all the current Xboxes, obviously, and like they would still support them, I imagine, to a certain extent. Obviously, like 20 fucking years down the road, they're not going to still support it. But, like, the Xbox XI, whatever the next version would be, they just wouldn't make it. So it'd be like PlayStation 6, no new Xbox.
I don't know. There has been kind of like an unconfirmed rumor that Xbox, there won't be another generation of Xbox.
Well, let's see what Phil Spencer has to say.
Let us see what Phil Spencer has to say. He didn't really honestly say too much. So, Xbox had Phil Spencer to reveal the future of Xbox next week. Phil Spencer has announced that business update event will take place next week, which will reveal the company's vision for the future. If you're an Xbox fan, you're more than likely wondering exactly what the heck is going on at the moment with all these rumors regarding certain exclusives coming to other consoles. Over the past few days, it's been heavily rumored that from credible sources that the likes of Hi-Fi Rush and Sea of Thieves, as well as more recent upcoming games like Starfield, Indiana Jones, and The Great Circle, will be coming to PlayStation systems pretty soon. It's caused an outcry among Xbox fans worried about their system of choice, an outcry so loud that even the new Xbox, head Phil Spencer has had to acknowledge the backlash in a recent tweet via his personal Twitter account. Spencer explains that he is aware of the current backlash and has announced that a business update event will take place next week, which will outline Spencer's vision for the future of Xbox. We're listening and we hear you. We've been planning a business update event for next week, where we look forward to sharing more details with you about our vision for the future of Xbox. Stay tuned. So he didn't dismiss the rumors, but he didn't confirm certain parts of the rumors. Which leads me to speculate that a portion of this is true.
Probably.
So that's all the information that Spencer's willing to dish out at the time, and we're yet to get a date for this business update event, quote-unquote. But at least we'll get some official answers to what's actually going on, rather than a vague teases from industry insiders. Just the sheer existence of the event implies that at least some of the rumors are true. Otherwise, Spencer would just outright deny them. But we'll have to wait and see exactly what Xbox has planned in regard to launching games on PlayStation. I'm looking forward to this event because I'm curious myself. Like, what does this mean? Like, what is this event going to really detail? Like, what is the future of Xbox? If we're going to talk about the future of Xbox, what does that mean?
Mm-hmm.
You know? What is the future?
If
there is a future. And that's the thing that I'm interested in seeing. Like, does he have plans for the future of Xbox? Is there going to be one for a future for Xbox? Or is this like going to be like Microsoft has worked out a new deal with Sony?
Because if it's not profitable, you can honestly see them not continuing down the road. Like, if something's not profitable, you're not going to continue to fucking waste the money on it.
Well, here's another thing to consider with the console wars between Sony and Xbox, right?
It's really more of a controller war now. It's which controller do you prefer with so much crossplay going on?
Yeah, I know. But okay, so here's the point I was getting at, why like this could potentially be a problem if there is no more Xbox. The Xbox has always been catered to the American market, the Western market. Whereas the PlayStation is, yes, catered to the American market. However, the industry is out of Japan. If Xbox goes away, you know, Japan is the only one in the within the consoles now. Because you got Nintendo and you got PlayStation. So Japan holds the whole market in consoles.
They're smart people.
They're smart people, but that is why I'm saying that, like, Japan will hold a monopoly on consoles. Because guess what? The Americans don't have a fucking any competing product to compete with PlayStation. So now PlayStation has no competition.
Maybe we should step it the fuck up, people.
I mean, they've been trying, but the problem is, it's like the games they keep putting out are dog shit. Like, you've got Starfield, which was good for like a few hours, and then you get to the end game, and you're just like, the end game sucks. Actually, the whole thing about Starfield is just, it's so dated. I liked Starfield. I enjoyed my time with Starfield, but the longer I played it, the less I liked it. It was one of those games where I was like, graphically, yeah, this is like the best Bethesda game I've seen graphically. However, the substance of the game is extremely dated. Extremely. The writing is bad. The RPG aspects of that game are bad. Like, it's not good. And I had a feeling it wouldn't be good, but...
So No Man's Sky is still better.
No Man's Sky isn't even really considered an RPG. It's a fucking space survival game. By the way, Light No Fire, I'm excited for that.
Is that a new update coming out?
No. Light No Fire is a new game by that company.
Oh.
It's on one planet. Procedurally generated giant planet.
I did hear about that, actually.
And it's basically No Man's Skyrim. That's what everyone's calling it. It looks like Skyrim.
I have heard about this.
Instead of ships, you have dragons. That you can fly around on.
Dragging these nuts.
And it's like, I'm excited to see that. I mean, it's good to see that they decided to scale down the scope as opposed to like the fucking 18 quintillion planets.
Yeah.
You know, like you can only put so much in space before everything looks the same. But
which is very true.
I know. And
there's very small variations with every planet.
It's mostly the fucking same. But with Light No Fire, you've got one planet that has all of, like, you can throw in a bunch of different things to your heart's content up to a point, but enough to where it feels like there's differences in every region, right? Mm. And you don't have to worry about, doing this for multiple planets. You have just the one planet. So I'm interested to see how that goes.
I'd be down for that.
I'm excited for it. But like the console wars thing, like I've never been a big person about the console wars. I'm a gamer. I like games. I don't give a fuck what platform it's on. Like, I just got a PlayStation so I could play the PlayStation games and a PC so that I could play the Xbox games. So if I'm being honest.
I've got a PC. I just don't like playing. I've never been a PC gamer. Dude, games that like you can use a controller on, it just doesn't feel the same to me, and I don't really like it, honestly.
Dude, you're missing out on the best part of PC gaming, though, which is the games that you can't get on consoles. That's where the gems are. I'm being honest. Like, a lot of the really good games that I've played are PC games. They're not...
I know, and I understand. That part does suck. I agree.
And but you have a PC.
I don't like playing on PC. It's usually not that fun to me.
Bro,
I don't know why. I don't know why. I really don't know. I can't explain it.
I don't understand. That logic doesn't make sense to me because...
It doesn't make sense to me.
You have a library of games that you can't get on your PlayStation.
I didn't say it was logical. I'm just saying I don't enjoy it.
And on top of that, what if there is a game that you can only get on the fucking Xbox Game Pass that you really, really, really want to play?
Granted, I do have the Steam Deck, so the Steam Deck is kind of taken away from a lot of that because I can play a good majority of things that are only on
Steam
or on PC on my Steam Deck.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, so you are kind of getting that experience, but I don't know.
And that was one of the big reasons that I got a Steam Deck was for stuff like that.
Yeah. All right, we're going to talk about Ubisoft.
Trash.
So Ubisoft CEO defends Skull and Bones, $70 price tag, and says it's a quadruple A game. It's like the extra triple A.
Speaking of Ubisoft, do you see that the South Park people ditched them for the new South Park game?
Really? Who's doing it?
I can't remember. It's not going to be Ubisoft, though.
Interesting. So the high price of the upcoming High Seas Adventure came into question during an investor's call. Skull and Bones cost $70, or your local equivalent, and that's a hefty price tag for something that bears the trappings of a live service game, including an in-game store, battle pass, seasonal events, and premium currency. But Ubisoft CEO Yves Guillemot defended the cost of the investor's call today, saying that the high price is warranted because it's a quadruple A game. Not just a triple A, it's a quadruple A. Guillemot's statement came in response to a question from an analyst who suggested the price point could presumably limit the size of the player base. You will see that Skull and Bones is a full-fledged game, Guillemot replied. I doubt that. I don't really consider it that.
We've already covered it that it's not.
It's a very big game, and we feel that people will really see how vast and complete that game is. So it's really a full AAA, actually quadruple A game that will deliver in the long run. There's no such thing as a quadruple A game, by the way. Guillemot's response, it's a good game, is to be expected. What's interesting is the fact that Skull and Bones' price tag has come into question in the first place. I've listened to a lot of investor calls over the years, and I don't recall ever hearing a specific pricing decision questioned like that. Yeah, and I thought that too, that the investors were questioning the price tag. Mm. Like, hey, this game shouldn't be that expensive.
I mean, hell, even Helldivers is only like, what, $40?
$40, game? Yeah. In the Battle Pass, like, you don't really ever need it. It's, and the one thing I like about Helldivers is that the Battle Pass isn't, like, in your face.
Yeah. What I'm noticing is the Battle Pass is cosmetic, too.
Well, I mean, everyone's saying the Battle Pass for this is cosmetic also. Like, none of the shit, there's no XP boosters or anything in the fucking store. Which, even still, it's Ubisoft. I wouldn't put it past them actually adding that in the future. But you never know. So, let me get back to this. Discussions of industry-wide trends like the rise of the free-to-play model when the Capcom president, Haruhiro
Japanese guy
Tsushimoto said in 2023 that game prices are too low are common enough, but why are you charging so much for this one game is something else entirely. It's an implicit criticism. Publicly, Ubisoft has high hopes for Skull and Bones. It's one of two premium games Ubisoft is releasing in its fourth quarter alongside of Prince of Persia, The Lost Crown. And Guillemot said that it has the potential to establish itself as a new live experience over the long term.
I can hear myself echoing, by the way.
You can?
I think so. Never mind, it's gone.
Okay, weird. We'll have a sense of how long it's going to work out soon enough. The pre-release open beta is live now, and Skull Bones finally set to launch February 16th. Here's my prediction on Skull and Bones. I feel like the player base that knows what it is, likes it for what it is far outnumbered by the people that expect it to be Black Flag 2. So I have a prediction that the majority of the people that are going to be trying this game are going to go into it with an expectation that it is something that it isn't, and the people that do like it are fully understanding of what it is and enjoy it. Good on them. Like, you know, if you like the game, cool, good for you. Like, I'm happy that you like the game. But I don't think it's realistic to actually say that this live service game is going to last longer than a year.
Yeah.
I feel like the player base is going to drop off within a couple of months. And maybe by the first season, it'll pick back up. And then people will see, like, it's not what they were wanting. And then they'll put it down. And then Skull and Bones will just die off. I see that happening. Because if the fickle thing about live service games is that it has to be done in a way where it's done right. And what I mean by that is that you have to give the player base something to continuously feed on and enjoy to keep it alive. Otherwise, without your players, your live service dies. You know? If people stop playing your game, your live service model is done and your game dies. And, like, you got to shut it down like every other live service game out there. The problem that I have with live service games is that, like, you know, they charge these crazy price points for it. And they want you to spend more money on more shit. But the shit that they give you that you spend all that extra money on, the substance isn't worth the price point. And you're just like, what the fuck did I pay for this for? You know?
And the substance that they're giving you. Or that they, because they, so they don't like the live service games. The excuse of not giving you a whole lot of content in the beginning is because, like, oh, it's going to be continuously updated.
But they drip feed it to you, you know.
If they do, if there is stuff to drip feed too.
Right. Look at Halo Infinite. You know, that's a live service game, but they drip fed content and they still drip feed content to the point where the player base is revolted.
It's because there was barely any content to begin with.
Right. There was barely content to begin with, and they were drip-feeding content, so it was like, why the fuck am I still playing this? There's nothing here, you know? Skull and Bones, I fear, will also... like, because you can only do ship-to-ship battles for so long before you're just tired of it.
I don't know. Fucking World of Warships or whatever.
You mean War Thunder?
Yeah, War Thunder.
See, War...
people do that shit all fucking day.
Those kinds of games, though... are geared towards that audience, right? Ubisoft has never been in that.
Yeah.
So you got World of Warships.
Like the story-based line.
You got your World of Tanks, your World of Warships, your War Thunder. Like, you know, those players have played those games because they're simulation games. Well, War Thunder is a simulation game, right? Mm. That's a very niche player base that will stick with that. Skull and Bones is not that. You know?
Yeah, that's true.
It's like kind of like an open world RPG light is kind of how they're looking at it, where it's like you get to be the captain of a pirate ship and you just do pirate ship battles. The pirate ship battles is cool.
I'm the captain.
However, the thing about it is that, like, a lot of people expect that, like, you want to go board someone's ship after you defeat them. It's a cutscene. You don't actually get to do it. People want to actually do that. You can only watch so many fucking cutscenes of you of boarding someone's ship or, like, whatever, like the only actual out of your ship experience is in the vendors at the ports. That's it. There's no land exploration. There's no survival / RPG aspect of it, you know? Because, like, Sea of Thieves exists for that kind of shit.
Exactly. And that's where I think this game is gonna, people are gonna want what this game is
trying to be,
or at least originally attempted to be, and in like one aspect it may do it better, but they want the rest of the aspects that the other games already do pretty well,
and
they'll take that trade-off of, like, all right, well, this game doesn't do this one aspect this good, but it has everything else,
right?
And they're going to go back to it.
They're going to go, or they're going to go play that because they're going to, or they, let's say they're either go back to it or they're going to play that because they haven't played it before. But, and it has the things that they're looking for. Right.
Exactly.
So, like, yeah, I think that's what's going to happen. I really do think that's what's going to happen.
Like, you can't come in to an environment where, like, say, Sea of Thieves, you know, that game exists. You know, it's a very popular game. The aspects that it has, you can't not have those aspects and then also expect to be better.
Right.
Like.
I don't. It's. We shit on that game all the fucking time. And it's not even out yet. So. It's.
Speaking of the South Park that I mentioned before. Because it's not Ubisoft. It's THQ Nordic.
Wait, that's who made the other ones?
No. Ubisoft made the first two.
So THQ Nordic is making the new ones?
Yeah, the new one. It actually comes out next month. It comes out March 26th.
Oh, it's already done.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Because I remember seeing a trailer for it a while back. I was like, this is going to be fucking fire.
Interesting. Speaking of game development, I got to work on my game project.
Oh, yeah. I forgot about that.
Yeah. Like, fucking wonderful. Anyway.
Is it EUFN?
EUFN.
Sorry. Is it Unreal Engine?
Unreal 5? Yeah.
Yeah. Well, EUFN is just
so the game that I had, so the game that I'm making for the project, and granted, this is like just kind of a spitballed idea that I put out there, and me and this other guy are working on it. Basically, it's like an arena shooter where you can toggle on and off the gravity.
Continue.
That's it.
Oh.
It's like a PvP game where, like, you know, you have, like, you can just
remake Portal.
I mean, without it being Portal, you know, like, I'm just, it's like you could turn off the gravity to kind of change the dynamic of the whole map. That was the idea I was going with. It was something that, like, oh, this would be a fun little thing to do, to try out, to play with the physics of the engine, stuff like that. Kind of like, I was trying to come up with a game that, like, seemed simple, but also challenging in a way that, like, you know, like, we're getting graded on, like, is it fun and does it function? That's it.
Interesting.
Anyway,
you should give it to me to try it out.
That'll be tough to do because it'll just be a build. Anyway, so Pokemon is investigating Pal World for potential IP infringement, and here's what to know about the controversial game that's gone viral. Now, there are cases in this where I'm like, that's a little bit sus. You know?
I think the most that'll come of this will be they'll have to change the appearance of some of the pals.
No, I mean, like, a little bit sus, as in, like, there are some pals where I'm like, that is a fucking damn near one for one of that Pokemon.
That's what I mean. Where, like, the only thing that'll come of this is they'll have to change the appearance of some of the pals.
Probably.
They'll be like, it's not, it's too close, or the percentage of difference isn't enough. So they'll have to, like, tweak it a little bit in the overall sense. I don't think they have a case.
So, it says, after several days of speculation, the Pokemon Company and Nintendo have signaled that they are investigating Pal World, a viral Pokemon clone that has sold over 8 million copies in less than a week. Now, this, mind you, this article is like over a week old. Actually, 2 weeks old. Pal World is an open-world survival game available for Windows, PCs, and Xbox consoles that has stirred controversy in the past week due to its in-game characters' close resemblances to the titular creatures of in the popular Pokemon games on Nintendo systems. While Pokemon allows players to capture, trade, and battle their creatures, Pal World dials up the violence by allowing players to beat up Pokemon like critters known as pals, while also allowing characters to wield guns and other weapons. You can also make your own sweatshop out of them, too.
Yes.
Despite the game appearing to clone popular Pokemon designs, its addition of shooting, survival, and a few other fresh mechanics, along with the fact that it's not exclusive to Nintendo consoles, appears to have struck a chord with players, with the title topping the sales chart on the PC gaming storefront on Steam.
It's like if Pokemon were made in America.
Pretty much, yeah. It's funny because the guy that came up with it was looking for a Japanese developer that knew how to design guns because they wanted to appeal to the American market because they said that Americans love shooting shit. So some have accused the game's publisher Pocket Pair of using AI to plagiarizing popular Pokemon designs, with some users pointing to its creator's earlier comments in favor of AI used in game design, although no evidence of this has been made public. Like the AI thing.
That would be interesting, though. And that could actually make a lot of sense as to why they're so close.
Yeah. I mean, if they copy the designs or if they used AI.
Yeah, if they used AI.
See, there's no evidence of the AI part. There is some potential evidence that they did copy the models of a Pokemon and just altered the way they looked. So,
which is not illegal.
So the other controversy around Pal World stems from the nature of its content, as the game allows players to kill and eat their pals and put them to work in factories or even enslave human characters. Yeah, I've done that.
Yeah, because you can capture
people.
The merchant dudes.
You can capture anybody. So we have received many inquiries regarding another company's game. This is Nintendo or Pokemon. We have received many inquiries regarding another company's game released in January 2024. We have not granted any permission of the use of Pokemon intellectual property or assets in that game. We intend to investigate and take appropriate measures, the Pokemon company said in a statement. Power World's chief creator, Takuro Mizobi, tweeted, "The company is receiving slanderous comments about our artists, and there are some tweets that appear to be death threats. I've received various opinions about Power World. I would appreciate it if you would refrain from slandering the artists involved in Power World." 8 million. That's the number of copies of Power World has sold since launch 6 days ago, making it the fastest-selling game of the year so far and one of the fastest-selling games ever.
This is on January 25th, by the way.
Yes. According to SteamDB, a video game download site, Power World hit a peak of 2 million concurrent players on Wednesday, becoming only the second game in history to do so after the Battle Royale shooter PlayerUnknown Battlegrounds, PUBG.
That's crazy.
I know. Pokemon started life as it beat Counter-Strike. It beat,
which is insane.
Counter-Strike.
Like when I saw that, I was like, that's fucking impressive.
Pokemon started life as a role-playing game in 1996, developed... I don't give a fuck about the history of Pokemon. Nintendo and the Pokemon Company's initial silence about Power World was a surprise to many who had followed the usual litigious Nintendo. The first sign of Nintendo moving against the popular game came Wednesday, at the time of this article, when a player who was planning to release mods for the game said that they had been hit with a copyright strike from Nintendo. The fan created a mod that would have swapped pals in the game with 3D models of Pokemon.
So they actually did. They released it. I saw a video of it.
I did too.
And it was fucking hilarious.
It was.
But I knew the moment that shit came out,
Nintendo was going to be like,
shut
it was
gonna the fuck yoink, down.
Pull that motherfucker out. So he also was about to put out an Ash Ketchum mod. The website Nexus Mods, largest online repository for PC game mods, also said it is not comfortable hosting PAL World mods featuring Pokemon designs. Given PAL World's similarity to Pokemon franchise, hosting content that adds copyrighted characters or assets into the game is almost certainly going to put us at risk of legal action. So Nexus Mods is cracking down on the kinds of mods that you can put for PAL World.
Which is good for them as well.
Now, it'll be interesting because I honestly don't think they have a case.
I don't think they do either.
I don't think they do. I really
because they've
don't.
Had so much time.
They've had one. Not only have they had so much time, but you would think that a company like that, or a company like the guys that made Power World, they would have done some checks and balances to make sure they weren't actually.
Yeah.
There was no way that this could get legally taken to court.
And they have. And everybody knows fucking Nintendo. Nintendo will come after you over the smallest fucking thing.
Yeah, they will.
And that infringes on them.
Their fucking legal team with Nintendo has been known to go to people's fucking houses.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, knock on doors and threaten people. Like, their legal team is, like, the mob. So, or the Yakuza, because it's Japan. But, which is the mob. But, yeah, like... I don't think they'll actually have a case here unless there's some shit that we just haven't seen that the developers of Power World have tried to hide that are going to get found. I don't know.
I don't think so. The only thing I can see is they'll have to, there's a few that they'll have to slightly change the design a little bit more to or something like that. Because otherwise, the game is entirely different. Honestly.
It really is.
It is what everyone that's adults now that loved Pokemon wanted Pokemon to become as the years went on.
Right.
And Pokemon remained the fucking same, didn't do what the people wanted. So the people that made Power World are like, we'll fucking do it. We just won't make it Pokemon. We'll make it similar.
we'll give you something. We'll give you what you want, but in a different way.
Exactly.
With great success comes great issues. So... The dev team behind PAL World is not a big dev team.
No, not at all.
And they had no idea that this game would take off the way that it did.
We didn't. When we reported on it, we're like, this game is going to be a fucking joke. It might get a few people to play it because it looks funny. And we were like, if Nintendo doesn't shut it down.
And then
right?
That's the thing. I started seeing people play it. I'm like, what is that? I'm like, oh, that's... that fucking Pokemon game. I was like, I was like, everyone's been talking about how good it is. So I'll fucking try it. And I tried it and I was like, this is really fun.
Yeah.
The only thing that I hate about it is the building mechanics. The building is the worst I've ever seen in any game like it. So I hope they overhaul that. But anyway, because they are a small dev team and they weren't anticipating, like, nobody could predict how popular this would be. They are scattering to try to find people. And Microsoft has decided to help them. Microsoft will help PalWorld.
Big Daddy coming. We'll give you support.
We'll help you, girl. It's okay. Microsoft will help PalWorld scale up as one of its all-time biggest Game Pass launches, because it was also on Game Pass.
While 7 million. That's 7 million on Xbox.
That's fucking nuts. While the success of PalWorld has taken place mostly on PC, a little more than a third of its massive player base has actually come through its partnership with Microsoft. It also debuted on Xbox Game Pass. PalWorld revealed that it now has 19 million players total since launch 2 weeks ago, and the game's still clocking 1 million concurrent players a day after becoming Steam's second highest played game ever. Now, you got to think, you said they lost 1.9 million players, right? They still have over 1 million players.
Exactly. Like, that's insane. And it's a pre-alpha.
Yeah, it's early access, which is even crazier.
They're just letting us play the game right now to be like, hey, let us know how things are going so we can change things. Like that's exactly what they were expecting. They were like, all right, a few people will play this. We'll get some feedback. We'll continue to change it. And like, if they want, they can still keep playing it. It's amazing in a pre-release alpha.
I know.
Like,
and it's not even
fucking crazy.
It is crazy. So PalWorld revealed now it has 19 million players total since its launch 2 weeks ago. But over on Xbox with 7 million players, this is actually Game Pass's third biggest launch ever, and it's the biggest third party launch on Game Pass. Period. I believe only Starfield and Halo Infinite are above it.
You know what pisses me off though about this? This small ass dev team in this pre-release alpha have released such a phenomenal game. Well, honestly, when you think about it, really not that many issues. When you truly break it down.
Yeah, I mean, there are a myriad of issues, but it's not like other fucking games that I've played.
Well, let's go to fucking Call of Duty.
It's not broken. Let's put it that way.
Right? Let's go to Call of Duty, this AAA fucking billion-dollar company. Breaks the game every small update that they make, right?
Yeah.
Meanwhile, like 10 people are made this beautiful, fantastic game pre-release alpha. They're like, we're not even done with it, guys. We don't know what to tell you. It may be fucked up. Everyone's like, this game's phenomenal. What are you talking about? Every year, people get AAA games, and they're like, can you fix the fucking game before you release it?
Aside from the AI, there's one bug that happened that like was affecting everybody, and that was the Lift Monk effigies. So there was that potion that you can drink to reset your stat points, but it was also resetting your effigies. So, like, your capture power was getting reduced to, like, the start capture power by drinking this potion. But because you already had all the effigies, you can't raise it again. So they put in a patch to fix it, but what happened was that patch inverted it. So the more effigies that you used, the lower your capture power was going to get. So it became damn near impossible to fucking catch pals. It was rough. Dude, I was wasting, like, I didn't get legendary spheres yet. I had the hyper spheres, which was like just under legendary. And I was throwing them at pals that had like a 90% catch rate, and I would waste 20 of these fucking things. And my effigy rank was 9, almost maxed, and I couldn't catch anything at 90% capture rate. It took me 20 or more spheres to finally get it. I wasted all my spheres trying to catch this one pal because it was like a boss pal, and that's the one I wanted. But the capture rate said it was so high, and I'm like, yeah, why are you breaking out of this? And even then, like little ones that shouldn't give you a problem. I had some that were at 100% still break out.
Wow.
Because my capture power was actually lower than that.
And those are the types of things that honestly
they did fix it.
Yeah. Honestly, those types of things, when someone tells me this is a pre-release alpha and they're like, you can play it. We're not done with it. Here you go.
Yeah.
Those are the types of things that I would expect. I'd be like, even still. Not that fucking bad.
Right. So now Microsoft, having been struck by lightning via a game that was not supposed to be anywhere close to this kind of hit, sees an opportunity and is stepping in. It has been announced that Microsoft will be working directly with Pocket Pair to improve the game on Xbox and perhaps more generally as well. From the press release, on Xbox's part, we're working with Pocket Pair to help provide support for Xbox versions of the game. We're providing support to enable dedicated servers, offering more engineering resources to help with GPU and memory optimization, speeding up the process to make PAL World updates available for players, working with the team to optimize the title for our platform.
That's huge. Yeah, the dedicated server thing, because I bought the Xbox for my wife, and she's been playing Power World, and she loves it. And she played with one of her friends, and what they noticed is dedicated servers are only on PC. So, like, when her friend joins...
Only through Steam, not on Game Pass. I want to be clear on that.
And, like, so when her friend joins her world, all the progress that they make together in her world...
Stays in that world.
Stays in that world, right. So... If her friend plays by herself, she can't join that world. Like, there's not a code she can give her.
She has to start her own.
She can't access it. Yeah. She can't join that same world without her being the host. So, that coming to Xbox would be huge.
Yeah, it would be. Or, like, a way that where the fucking servers just kind of stay all the time.
Think of it like this.
So, Valheim, for example, right? So there's a server that I made in Valheim that me or Alicia can play, and neither one of us has to be on. Well, actually, yeah, no, I take that back. Alicia does have to be on for me to be in that.
So the way Lego Fortnite works is you have six keys that you can give people because it's your server. You can give six people access to that server to where they can play it anytime, right? And then they can invite friends to it. So
how many people are you really going to have in your server, realistically? Probably not.
That's
more
what I
than
mean.
That.
Exactly. But like, you can give six people access to play that server whenever they want.
There are even older games that have done that too. The Empyrean, like the game that I played with some guys in Regiment, like with Oakley and shit. Empyrean Galactic Survival. One person could create a server. And that server stays in the server browser, and you can, if you have the access key, you can join that server, and they don't even have to be online for it.
Yeah, I think they should do that for Xbox, what they may end up doing.
They'll probably do it in the future. But anyway, PAL World is certainly not the most optimized game, and it struggled more on Xbox than PC, but Microsoft wants to change that, and if they can help with things like dedicated servers, that would be a huge boon for the game. One of the biggest open questions is whether PAL World will be able to capitalize on this moment and produce new content in a timely manner. That is a big one. The problem is they have a whole lot of fixes to get through first. And I doubt Microsoft is going to help them, say, fix AI pathing and bases, for instance. And Pocket Pair has announced that they will add huge scale projects like PvP and PvE endgame raids to the game, where, again, this is a very small team, and I don't think Microsoft is just absorbing them to make stuff like this happen. It's going to be a long road. But whatever happens now, PAL World is one of the wildest industry success stories in recent memory. Complaints about Pokemon copying have started to die down, as Nintendo and the Pokemon Company have taken no real action against the game, implying that there's nothing really there.
Exactly.
Yeah, so they announced that they were going to investigate, and nothing so far has come out of it. Now it can just focus on improving and scaling, and it appears it will have some help in doing so.
I think the bad part about this is going to be because of its success in its early access state, a lot of people are going to expect and want a lot more than is even possible.
Yeah, I mean, the most that I honestly expect is just content. That's it. Like, more areas, more pals, and then just,
well, and of course, you gotta think
like improvements.
That's in the plans.
It is in the plans, yeah. I don't expect anything to be drastically different than it is now. I just expect more areas, more worlds, more pals, raids, more bosses. And the other thing I hope they change is that, like, doing the towers don't actually give you any reward whatsoever for doing them. You don't get XP. You don't get anything at the end of those tower bosses. There's no point of doing them, except to do an get your achievement done. Aside from that, like, there is no point to doing them. I tried this. You get more out of just fighting the alpha pals, like the other bosses, any of the world little bosses throughout the world, then you then and you don't get anything out of the boss fight, out of the actual like tower boss, which I find weird because that's
yeah, it's a little strange
because that's harder to do than fighting an alpha pal. Yet you get more from an alpha pal than you do from a tower boss, which is essentially nothing.
It might just be an asset or something they haven't added yet.
I hope they do soon. But
have you tried to go to the big tree?
I know you can't. I did try. I tried flying my Flaris out there, and there's an invisible wall stopping you. All right,
I thought that was the funniest shit ever.
So back to the military. Sacked commander accuses sailors of mansplaining and put her hands on them. In what way? So new information about what led up to the sacking of naval commander last year has been released in an official Navy report. Captain Danielle DeFont was removed from command of the guided missile cruiser USS Lake Erie, what a fucking name, on October for loss of confidence in her ability to command. But the recently released command investigation report revealed details about a culture of fear created by her during her 14 months in command. According to a report first obtained by KPBS, DeFont routinely berated officers in front of other members of the crew as well as put her hands on them. In one reported incident, DeFont grabbed a conning officer by his collar after he responded to a question she asked the officer on deck. At the time, the ship was conducting a moored buoy operation in the San Diego coast. On the bridge, DeFont asked out loud, "Do I have a safe bearing? Do I have safe bearing?" And the ship's conning officer said that she did. After grabbing his collar, pulling him close, whispered, "I was talking to you, not the OOD."
"You're not the OOD." She's saying that he wasn't the OOD. I was talking to the officer of the deck.
"Was I talking to you? You're not the OOD. I was talking to the OOD. Don't ever interrupt me again." Fucking sounds like the cunt was on a power trip. Sailors told Navy investigator they felt very... They felt they had to walk on eggshells and described her yelling so loud it could be heard in the ship from behind closed doors. Captain DeFont's behavior consisting of yelling, profanity, and public admonishments and contributed to a culture of fear on board, the investigation states. In another reported incident, when a sailor attempted to answer her question by first explaining the situation, she said she didn't need his mansplaining. One officer told investigations she constantly bullied them with scoldings, but the Navy found no paper trail of performance issues or suggested counseling for the officer. The excessive nature of Captain DeFont's reprimands exceeded a reasonable standard for correcting professional deficiencies or providing constructive feedback to improve performance, the investigation notes. In the opinion of the investigating officer, Captain DeFont's actions exceeded any proper military purpose and were belittling and humiliating. Sounds like this bitch was on a fucking absolute power trip.
I'm not gonna lie. Look at this picture. To 100% judge a book by its cover, she kind of looks like a bitch.
She absolutely looks like a fucking raging bitch. And look at the faces of everybody here. They are miserable. The one chick
right next to her in the picture, in the
just
black
like
and
looking
tans.
At her like she wants to slit her throat.
Yes.
Yeah, she's looking at her like, "I'm gonna kill this fucking bitch."
Like this fucking bitch.
And then the one that's like two next to her and they're what looks like their fucking mechanic suit. She's got that look on her face like, "Please get me off this boat. Please get me off this boat."
It's coveralls.
Whatever, dude. She's in her coveralls. And she's got that look on her face like, "I want to get the fuck off this ship now."
She looks like she's miserable.
Yeah. She does look like she's miserable. And this chick behind her like wants to stab her like she's in a fucking prison. Like like she looks like she's going to fucking pull out a shiv and just open her kidneys up.
I could imagine why we have such a recruiting and retention problem.
I don't know. Like I said, toxic leadership. You know, it's a farce. It's not real. None of it's true. It just blows my mind. Like, you know... Like
speaking of you saying that, you gotta play this.
Play what?
I'm gonna send it to you. You'll see it. It's a 19 second clip on TikTok. You'll see it. It's exactly what I took it from. Oh, you might even be able to play it in Discord.
Hang on, I just got all the fucking graphic assets. I accidentally opened them. Where's the TikTok? Where'd you send it?
Oh, whoops. Let me delete that.
Where did you send that?
I sent it in the staff chat.
You fucking idiot. That's all right. Let me turn this down a little bit. Your voice is going to be minimized. I'm going to open this up.
That's fine.
It's all a fugazi. You know what a fugazi is?
Fugazi. It's a fake.
Oh, yeah.
It's a wazi. It's a woozy. It's a fairy dust.
Wolf of Wall Street.
It's never landed. Yeah. It is no matter. It's not on the elemental chart. It's not fucking real.
Right?
All right. Stay with me. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
It doesn't exist.
It doesn't exist. It's not real. Yeah, okay. Now I remember what you're talking about. At first, I was like, what the fuck are you saying?
It doesn't exist. It's fairy dust.
It's interesting because it's like, you know, toxic leadership is a thing in the military as a whole. Like, and then, like, you see this shit. Like, Navy has a massive problem with recruiting and retention right now. And it's shit like, I wonder how many more of these cunts are in command. You know?
There's a lot. So on the ship that I've been on, frequently lately, that the leadership on there is so bad. Like, I did a leadership course, which is so much fun to do a leadership course to, like, E7s and above and officers.
We have that in the Army as well.
As an E5. Well, no, as an E5, though. Like, I'm giving a class. It's like a class that I give. And the Navy has this thing called the Mental Health Playbook. It's the best thing I've ever seen the Navy put out as far as related to mental health and leadership. Phenomenal read. It's on the official Navy website. And I devised a course for it, like a short course class that I give in like under an hour. And I only give it typically to E6 and above. And I love giving it to E7s, which is, you know, the cult of the Navy, the chief's mess.
Yes, yes.
And above. And it's so much fun to give it because I'm an E5. You can tell the ones that are likely the shit leaders in there because they immediately dismiss you because you're a second class. Because I'm giving a class to them and they're like, the fuck am I going to learn from him? That already tells me that you're probably part of the problem, right?
I love doing
that because they're the ones that I target and ask them questions in different scenarios throughout.
Good.
My presentation.
Good. Because that fucking shit needs to happen because they are the reason why that these issues are a fucking problem. Like, listen, if you're watching this and you are in a position of leadership within the military, stop. And I'm not saying that you are. If you're the one contributing to these fucking issues or you don't think you are, you probably are. I mean, there are some out there that I can guarantee, I know I'm not part of the problem. I've seen the problem. I'm not it. But there are some that, like, I don't know, I don't ever really see a problem. I don't think it's an issue. Then you are part of the fucking problem. You know,
yeah.
if
people don't come to you with criticism because they're not comfortable coming to you with criticism.
They're not comfortable coming to you at all.
Yeah, you're probably part of the fucking problem.
Yeah, so it's like a huge reflection time for leadership because we are staring down the barrel of World War III, right? You know,
literally
staring down the barrel of World War III. Right. And we're going into potentially another global conflict or another conflict in general. And you are now the leadership that your lower enlisted and shit are going to look up to for guidance for anything. And if you are a piece of shit leader, you're setting yourself up and everybody else below you and around you for fucking massive catastrophic failure.
You're going to get people killed in reality.
You are going to get people killed. Like toxically, and that's the thing why toxic leadership has been able to thrive for as long as it has. Because conflict has been kind of tapering off for the last, I don't know, 10 years or so. Because you had the wind down of Afghanistan, and now we're not in a conflict anymore. Everything's just training rotations and all of the bullshit. Like most of our fucking NCOs and stuff have never deployed or never done anything. And I can't really say that I'm one of them because I know I'm not. I didn't go to Afghanistan. I went to other places, but it wasn't Afghanistan. So it was like, and the reason why I left is because I was getting leadership that was the same as me that were just like becoming toxic because they had no experience and all the people with experience were leaving. And now we're going into another conflict and all these people that are fucking toxic have rose the ranks and now they're fucking steering the ship, either metaphorically or literally, and you're going to get people killed. It's going to be a fucking mass. It's going to be a mess. Whenever the next conflict happens and you have these kinds of leaders and we actually get into a fucking conflict with anybody, it's going to be a fucking disaster because...
Oh, we're screwed.
And not,
we're going to lose more people than we should.
We are going. It's going to be terrible because two things are going to happen. Toxic leadership is going to weed itself out. That is guaranteed to happen. If we get into a massive conflict, the next one, toxic leadership is going to weed itself the fuck out because they're either going to die or get fired.
Mm-hmm.
And then good leadership is going to fucking rise again. It's one of those. It goes with that saying. Weak men create hard times create strong men create good times, and then the cycle repeats itself. It's how the military culture is. You know, we're currently in good times. We got weak people fucking leading us into bad times. Bad times are going to happen. The weak people are going to get weeded out. Strong people are going to rise. And this is the metaphor I'm using for toxic leadership. Bad leadership stems from good times. Bad leadership creates bad times. Bad times create good leadership. Good leadership creates good times. You know, it's just a cycle in the same way of leadership.
And I think that's a problem. The Navy, one of the reasons I think the Navy has had some of the worst leadership, and it's such a problem in the Navy, is because we haven't had any. No one's fucked with the Navy for fucking centuries. Well, decades.
Unless you don't consider the Houthi that fucking.
No, I'm talking about before recently.
Yeah. Well, yeah, and that's true. Since the Iraq War. Even with the Iraq War, I think the Iraq War was the last time that the fucking Navy just laid the fucking hate on shit.
The number of incidents that have involved the Navy have been isolated ships.
Right.
In very specific situations and for very, very short times. So, and rightfully so, no country wants to fuck with the Navy because they know our capabilities. No one's...
Temper.
No one's fucked with us because they know what we can do and what their capabilities are. And honestly, even right now, the only people that are fucking with us are dumbasses that are being paid and they're paying the price for it. But no one's fucked with the Navy, and that's created that problem of a longer time frame of not shit for the Navy, right? It's just been like, when people talk about deployment, a deployment in the Navy is like you go out, you do your fucking thing, you see some ports, shit sucks. It's still a deployment. Like you're doing different operations. And in the reality sense, most of the time, no one's ever been in a dire situation, right?
Right. It's not
as far
like,
as wartime goes.
Yeah, it hasn't been like that for the Navy for a long time. That's why like... toxic leadership in the Navy has probably been a thing for a long, long time. Whereas like the Army has kind of just been stemming since like, I don't know, 2016, 2015 has been kind of growing from there. Marine Corps, I don't know when that shit started. I think that was like after like the Iraq wound down and they got pulled out of Afghanistan. So they were able to have their shitty leadership kind of like start sooner.
So I think the Marine Corps has always had shitty leadership. It's gone. There's effective and there's ineffective, and they're just not effective with their like that style of leadership. I will say has a purpose the way that the Marine Corps does it. You know what I'm saying? Like the toxicity in the Marine Corps sense has a purpose to wartime.
And when they're not in wartime, there's no purpose anymore.
Exactly. Then it's just toxic. You know what I'm saying?
And that's why it was becoming more notable after they weren't doing, like, deployments on the scale they were in Iraq.
Exactly. And like, there's a time and place, like, if you're being an asshole in wartime, you're not really being an asshole. Right? You're doing kind of what you have to do to essentially get your fucking point across. Or even for people to hear you. Now, you're just being an asshole.
Yeah, now you're just being a dick.
Right.
It's the same for the Army, though. Speaking of, and like recruiting and retention, people will do anything they can to not fucking join, including pretend to be mentally handicapped people. So South Korean EA FIFA pro guilty of faking low IQ to avoid military service.
You think about if the fucking U.S. implements the draft. So many people are going to be doing this.
There's a waiver for that now. It's the ASVAB's been lowered. So it's not uncommon to see most South Korean esports stars go off to complete their compulsory military service, or yeah, their compulsory military service. But one player has tried to outsmart the system by literally playing dumb. Chain Young, who played FIFA for Live Sandbox, reportedly tried to get out of his military service after originally being cleared for active duty, activity duty, following his grades in the state physical examination. According to Korea Herald, the esports pro faked his answers on a psychological test in order to be diagnosed with a medical disorders and an IQ of 53.
Which, I watched the Angry Cops video of this, and he shows, like, the bell curve of IQ scores. Medically, mentally retarded starts at 55. Like, the threshold goes from 55 to, like, 83 or something, I think.
So he scored lower?
53. Yeah, so he got a 53, where 0.1% of people...
Oh, wow.
Are in that bracket.
So he, like, basically, he could have answered some things a little bit better to kind of bring him up a notch to make him not seem that, to make him seem, oh, that's plausible.
Yeah.
But no.
So, like, when they see it, they're like, how are you able to walk in here without a helmet?
Essentially, yeah. Like, so he put himself in a category where a person is severely mentally handicapped.
Yes.
And it's like, you're not severely mentally handicapped where you have to be, like, escorted around by somebody and, like, you have someone, like, a caretaker with you at all times.
Exactly. Like you walked in here for this test. What are you fucking talking about?
Your test scores is of a person that's that, and you are clearly not that. So, okay.
I think he's faking.
Despite faking the test results to get out of his basic military training, Won Chain Yun would still have to have been required to serve as social service personnel. So they were saying, no matter what you are doing something. Unfortunately, police caught wind of this, and after an investigation, he was indicted for draft dodging. On Monday, January 29th, an Incheon district court found the FIFA and EAFC pro guilty of violating the Military Service Act. He was sentenced to 1 year in jail and must complete 120 hours of community service. Well, I mean, technically, he still avoided the service. Won Chain Yun, who retired from esports back in August following his indictment, was still producing content for YouTube. Following the court's decision, Gamer posted his AfriCat account, saying that he was preparing a statement and apologized to fans. The longer statement still has yet to be released. What is this? Let me turn that down. That's fucking loud.
Does it have translation on it?
Hey, well, yeah. Oh, no, it's not. The subtitles are in Korean, too. Dude, Korean is nuts. Like, I don't think I've ever really sat down and listened to what Korean sounds like. This dude's fucking talking quick, man. If I was learning Korean, I'd be fucked. I wouldn't even know where to begin.
Yeah, you can barely read and speak English. You'd be absolutely fucked.
Thanks, man.
You had to know that that was coming. You set me up for it and just laid it out.
This video that they put in this article is completely useless. Like, there's no subtitles. It's all in fucking... Oh, wait, what is the closed caption? Yeah, closed caption is even in Korean, too. What the fuck?
How dare they not put English in there?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know what the fuck he's saying. I really don't. I'm assuming he's talking about FIFA because it's a video of him playing FIFA. But yeah, so like this dude essentially tried to bullshit his test to make him seem like he was severely mentally handicapped. What was it? What was it? Hang on. He had multiple tests done. It was a...
Yeah, yeah. So he went to his doctor and tried to get, like, all types of stuff
psychological done. Tests in order to be diagnosed with mental disorders and an IQ of 53. Okay.
So I guess he ended up getting diagnosed with, like, fear of big crowds. And we're like,
there's a waiver
for that. The guy that goes to large stadiums and plays
video games for hundreds of thousands of people, like, is afraid of big crowds?
You're afraid of big crowds, yet you are actively embedded into them, like, for your esports career. It's funny because K-pop bands have been getting drafted, too, because it is mandatory service. So, like,
yeah,
some of the K-pop bands, all the members got thrown in the fucking military. How long is the South Korean mandatory service, by the way?
I think it's only 2 years. I know. Most countries that I know of that were allied with are only like 2 years. Like Israel's 2 years.
The UK is one.
Is it one?
It's
UK has mandatory service?
Yeah, UK is one. And then it's like,
I didn't know that.
You have a choice to stay in, like every 6 months they ask you, like, do you want to stay in? If you don't, you can leave.
So really? They're mandatory service 1 year?
That's what they told me when I saw them overseas. Does the UK have mandatory military service?
I don't think they do.
Maybe it wasn't the UK. Hang on. Which I know Greece does. Which European countries have mandatory military service?
Countries,
Lithuania, Denmark, Sweden, Norway, Finland, Latvia, Austria, Greece, and Estonia currently have some form of compulsory military service.
It's like all fucking Middle East countries.
How long is South Korean mandatory military service? 18 to 21 months.
I didn't see South Korea on here.
Because it's not a European country, is it?
No, I did countries with mandatory military service.
Oh, well, I put how long? Well, you got to be specific probably on Korea. So North Korea is forever.
South Korea is a country.
So under South Korean law, most able-bodied men must perform 18 to 21 months of military service. Dude, that's like a year and a half.
Oh, this is a much better site.
That's like nothing.
21 to 24 months for males. Scheduled to decrease to 18 to 22 months.
This is interesting.
Okay, so 2022, it went down to 18 to 22 months, so just under 2 years.
Special exemptions are granted for athletes and classical artists who excel in certain kinds of international competitions tied to national prestige.
Yes, and so esports is one of those. So Angry Cops talked about that too. He was like, if you're like super, super good at esports and you're not just in your mom's fucking basement playing FIFA, Like he is very good. He's won multiple championships, like first place, third place on like these big things, but he wasn't at the level that the country is like, you're still going. There's a lot of countries with mandatory service.
Oh, I know. I honestly think we should too.
To an extent. I disagree though. Well, okay. The reason I disagree is because it's a cliche, but You've seen Pearl Harbor, right? The love story.
Yeah. The love story? The movie?
It's basically a love story.
The fucking Ben Affleck movie?
Yes.
Yeah, I've seen it.
So, one of the things that General Doolittle says, he's like, nothing is stronger than the heart of a volunteer, which is true. One of the reasons that our military is so good is because we all choose to be here.
Yeah, that's true. The reason my logic behind why I think it should be a mandatory minimum of 1 year for everybody is because of the experience. Well, I'd probably dare say 2 years, depending, because like some jobs can actually fucking put you in school longer than your service would be if it was only 1 year.
Mm-hmm.
And I only say that is because you do learn some valuable skills from being in the military. It's life skills. You know?
Yeah.
And it's very beneficial. It is a very beneficial thing to do with your life. It's mindset changing almost, depending on who you are. For me, it definitely was, because like where I was before I joined the fucking army versus who I am today, not even the same mindset. Like, then again, I can also contribute that to being older. But had I not joined the military when I did, I probably would be a nobody, doing nothing with my life, just being a fucking complete fucking turd of society. Like, if I'm being honest, like doing the army, being in the army changed my mindset with a lot of things, like how I wanted to navigate goals, how I wanted to structure my future. Those things I could not have done had I not been in the army, because I had no concept of it. You know,
I do think there would be benefits with it, but in the sense of our force being as effective as I think that it has been, it's so much harder to force people to do shit that don't want to fucking do it.
I know.
Right? If we have a draft, I think.
But you still, there, you
it's
still,
gonna be so much harder to get people to do shit.
There's also on the other side of that, there are people that join the fucking military that don't really want to fucking do it. So why are they there? I ran into so many of that where there were people that were in the army, got to their unit, finished basic, finished all the other schools, got to their unit and just didn't want to fucking be there anymore. They still
had done more than someone that didn't want to join them in the first place.
I think there are a lot of cases that in my experience were that I don't even think that even would have mattered. They didn't want to be there even throughout the school, even throughout basic. They didn't want to be there. You get them to do anything. Good luck. Like they just it blows my mind. It's like you didn't.
I think that would be tenfold though.
It probably would, but it still blew my mind. That's just like, especially the people that like early in their enlistment. I'm talking like within the first year. Didn't want to fucking be there, and like throughout basic where they didn't want to fucking be there and they're looking for any way out. It's like you had the option to not do this, so why did you do it?
We process those people out most of the time.
What? Well, so yeah,
most of my fucking job is seeing those people that don't want to be here.
I always did finding it interesting in basic training for the people that didn't want to be there. It's just like, why did you do this in the first place? Like, why?
To be fair, a lot of them,
they don't know what they're getting into.
That, yeah, legitimately. I don't know what movies that they've been seeing where they think that boot camp is like all fucking shiny rainbow vacation with ice cream sherbet and shit. But I don't think I've ever seen a military movie where boot camp was like, I want to fucking do that.
No, everything that I've ever seen about basic training or boot camp has always been fucking horrendous.
Yeah, so like I literally went into boot camp. Where it's like, damn,
I'm not looking forward to that.
I went into boot camp imagining Full Metal Jacket. I was like, this is gonna suck. This is gonna suck fucking ass.
Same. I expected like to be hardcore. I mean, obviously, before you go, they kind of give you a more realistic idea of what it's gonna be like. And Doc froze. No, you froze. Yeah, you did. On my end, you did.
Am I still frozen?
No, you're good.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I don't know. Like, the mandatory service thing, it's like, you know, there are pros and cons for it. Because, like you said, a person that truly doesn't want to be there being forced to do it, good luck getting them to do anything, you know?
And if they do, they'll only do it so they don't fucking go to jail. And they'll do the bare fucking minimum.
I'm just here so I don't get fired, you know?
That all the time. But in the reality, I do a lot more. Because Ooh, this is a strong word. I generally like being in the military. And then I'll say the Navy. Otherwise, I wouldn't keep doing it. Mostly, it's the pay and benefits that's just pushing me along. But, like, if I truly fucking hated it, I would get out.
Yeah.
Right? And there are times where I'll do the bare minimum, honestly. We all have those times.
Those places
and leadership that we're like, fuck you, I'm doing bare minimum. But in those senses where someone, you're forcing someone into the military and they're like, I don't want to fucking do this at all. I don't want to fucking be here. They're going to do the bare minimum to get them to not go to prison.
Yeah. Yeah. This is true.
And they're going to bitch and complain about every single thing.
Oh, absolutely. And like,
more so than the average military person.
Yeah, yeah. All right. Well, that was it. That's all we had.
Well, thanks for coming to the first Barracks Party.
Welcome. Thanks for hanging out at the Barracks Party, kids. I think that flows pretty well. Thanks for hanging out at our Barracks Party. Thanks for joining the Barracks Party. Thanks for coming to our Barracks Party.
Like and subscribe to come to the next one.
Yeah, make sure
we gotta think of like a slogan or something.
We should probably kind of do the like and subscribe thing at the beginning, because you know, like and subscribe helps the algorithm. Like, subscribe, comment, share with your friends, share with your mom. Actually, don't
invite your friends to the party.
Invite your friends to the party. Let's go. But yeah, thanks for hanging out. It's been awesome. I'm glad that we finally got our fucking name changed. We'll have to record next week. Now that we got our rebrand done, now I'm motivated to fucking keep going. So, because before it was just like waiting for the brand change. I've just been like, it could be any day. When is it? And then on top of that, I got school. Like, dude, six classes is
daunting.
Dude, it is daunting. It's so rough. Like, I'm just like, I have five projects right now. I got a project, and one of my teachers says, I haven't given you any projects. I'm like, the midterm that you have us that's due in 2 weeks, you want us to build a website.
That's a project.
That's a project. On top of the website I have to do that is also a project for an actual client. That's, and that's due March 1st. Yeah.
Nah, fam. Fuck all that.
No, and we're just now getting graphics and stuff to add to the website because we needed photos of him because he's a political candidate in my town and he's running for like a seat and he wanted a website built for his campaign, which is honestly in the scope of it. If you know web development, like it's very minimal. There's not much you need to do with it. There's very little functionality involved. Like maybe a fucking homepage that talks about who he is and what he's running for. Another page, because he's an Air Force vet too, another page that talks about the issues that he wants to address in his seat, and then the third page is a contact page, which we've already got that set up, which that was going to be the hardest page, because all it was a form that someone would fill out and then hit submit and would email him. We already have that set up. That's the hardest part. The rest of it is just making it look good. Are you okay?
Still. You know when you get, like, a URI and you have, like, residual cough for fucking weeks after?
A URI, upper respiratory infection?
Correct, yes.
Why don't you say, you know when you get, like, a respiratory infection?
I'm used to saying URI.
Yeah, I mean, you are doc, so it does make sense. But, yeah, I know what you're talking about. Like, after you recover from being sick and you still have that residual cough afterwards...
Yeah, and like that throat phlegm and shit.
Dude, I've had that for a while still. Like, forever. Like, I think I got sick one time 2 years ago, and I've just had this little residual cough of and, like, this feeling of phlegm in my throat ever since. Like, and actually having phlegm in my throat. It's just a never-ending cycle. Like, my ENT says, well, you're fine. Everything's good. You just, you know, your sinus.
Mine's just that, like, I've noticed, like, every day it gets to be a little bit less cough, a little bit less. And then eventually it just all goes
cough,
away.
The cough tapers off like within a month. Like it takes forever for it to go away. Where like you feel better. Like your voice is like when I lost my voice that one time I got sick, I felt like it was never going to come back. I lost my voice for a fucking week and I was like, I never lost my voice for this long. And I thought it was never going to come back. I'm like, dude, I was freaking out. I'm like, I should see a doctor. Like I should go to the doctor and like, I think something's wrong. I think I have cancer or some shit. Like, I literally was, like, gaslighting myself to thinking that I was terminally ill.
I listened to that last episode that we did. When I was congested, I was like, I sounded terrible.
Oh, dude. Yeah. I mean, I wouldn't know. I don't remember. But, yeah. Is my beard getting gray right here?
I'm colorblind, so.
You can't see gray?
It looks the same to me.
At least you're not a pilot. Anyway, we're going
to
wrap
I'm
this.
Not allowed to be a pilot.
No, I know. You're not allowed to be a pilot. Anyway, let's wrap this up and jump on some fucking Helldivers, homie.
Oh, yeah?
I'm pretty sure that I have my my buddy that I said I was going to play with. I'm sure he DM'd me. Oh, no, he didn't DM me at all. Is he still playing? Let me go look at his voice chat real quick. Nope, he's not playing. So I guess we'll play with you.
If you're just... We'll end first.
We'll end first. Anyway, love you guys. Appreciate you all. Thanks for hanging out. And we will see you on the next episode of the Barracks Party. And I'm so glad I don't have to say smoke
see you at the next party.
Because I almost fuck. We'll see you at the next party. That does sound good. We'll see you at the next party. I almost said fuck another one. But anyway, love you all. Appreciate you. See you at the next party. Bye.